The primary assessment of checking the ABCDEs in ACLS is for unconscious patients in full arrest that are cardiac or respiratory in nature. ACLS healthcare providers should conduct the primary assessment after completing the basic life support assessment. And remember, this is comprised of checking for responsiveness with a tap and a shout. If they're unresponsive, we're going to call 911 or call a code depending on the area in which you work. Check for breathing and a pulse, and then attach the defibrillator and possibly defibrillate if there's no pulse. For conscious patients who may need more advanced assessments and management techniques, the healthcare professional will conduct the primary assessment first. In the primary assessment, you continue to assess and perform an action as appropriate until the patient is transferred to the next level of care. Many times, members of a high-performance team will perform assessments and actions in ACLS simultaneously. Now, it's important to remember, per the latest guidelines, that we want to assess the patient and then perform the appropriate action. Please keep in mind that when you get into the scenario-based testing with ProACLS, it's formatted in a linear fashion in order to simplify and clarify the vital skills needed to pass the test successfully. Now, that being said, I really want to reiterate that real ACLS codes will have many working parts, and many of them will all happen dynamically and simultaneously in order to expedite important assessments, treatments, and therapies in order to successfully save the patient's life. Now, the following is a breakdown of the ACLS primary assessment following the ABCDE method. First, airway. It's vital that we maintain an open airway in the unconscious patient. Ways that we can accomplish this is by head tilt, chin lift, or a basic airway adjunct like an oropharyngeal or nasopharyngeal airway. The advanced practitioner can use an advanced airway if a basic airway is not sufficient or if capnography is vital to the success of the resuscitation. Different forms of advanced airways include but are not limited to endotracheal tubes, esophageal tracheal tubes, laryngeal tube, or laryngeal mask. Keep in mind that the healthcare professional must weigh the cost versus the benefits of advanced airway placement compared to interrupting chest compressions. If the bag mask ventilation is adequate, the healthcare provider may wait to insert an advanced airway until the patient does not respond to the initial resuscitation attempts with CPR and defibrillation or until ROSC occurs. The advanced airway devices such as an LMA, laryngeal tube, or an SOA can be placed while chest compressions continue. It's important to confirm the proper placement of any advanced airway once it's placed. This can be done with a physical exam or quantitative waveform capnography readings. CPR should be properly integrated with ventilations after intubation is done in order to optimize pulse pressures and oxygenation of vital organs and cells. Because both movement with CPR and transportation can alter and dislodge the actual advanced airway, it's really important that we use a securing device so that we can hold that tube in place. Make note of your organization's protocols and operating procedures in order to use the proper and prescribed devices for tube immobilization. And lastly, be sure to monitor the airway placement with continuous quantitative waveform capnography. When assessing breathing, are the ventilations and oxygenation adequate? For arrest patients, we administer 100% oxygen, but for others, we'll want to titrate oxygen administration to achieve oxygen sats of 94% or greater by pulse ox. Secondly, are quantitative waveform capnography and oxyhemoglobin saturation monitored? We will, of course, rely on appropriate chest rise and fall to confirm breath compliance, but quantitative waveform capnography will help us understand how well our CPR and rescue breaths are oxygenating the patient and how well the patient is processing that oxygen from a biological perspective. It's vital that we assess and reassess the quality of CPR. Monitor the quantitative waveform capnography, and if PET CO2 is less than 10 millimeters of mercury, it may be a sign that we should work at improving CPR quality. Now, if we're able to monitor intra-arterial pressures and the relaxation phase or diastolic pressure is less than 20 millimeters of mercury, we should probably attempt to improve CPR quality by assessing depth, rate of compressions, as well as hand placement. Attach, monitor, and defibrillator for arrhythmias or cardiac arrest rhythms like ventricular fibrillation, pulseless ventricular tachycardia, asystole, or pulseless electrical activity. And lastly, we want to be sure and provide defibrillation cardioversion as needed. Obtain an IV or IO access to deliver adequate fluid replacement and medications, and give appropriate drugs to manage rhythm and blood pressure. Then, give IV or IO fluids if needed. Later, we're going to check glucose and then temperature, and check and correct, if possible, the perfusion. Next, we're going to talk about disability. When it comes to disability, we want to evaluate the following. Check the patient for neurologic function and quickly assess for responsiveness, levels of consciousness, and check for pupil dilation, which may indicate brain death or viability, but not in every case. And lastly, we're going to use AVPU, which is an acronym, to assess if the patient is A, alert, responds to V, voice, or P, painful stimulus, or is completely U, unresponsive. Exposure. Exposure reminds the healthcare professional to remove the patient's clothing and perform a good physical examination, looking for obvious and not so obvious signs of trauma, bleeding, burns, unusual markings, or medical alert bracelets.